knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we learned how to identify a fingerprint pattern. Identification of a fingerprint by categorizing their ridge flow into different patterns, such as arches, loops, and whorls, are known as level 1 details of a fingerprint. However, to identify an individual from a given fingerprint impression, the mere classification of the pattern is not enough. The fingerprint needs to have a sufficient number of matching ridge characteristics. These ridge characteristics are known as level 2 details. Individual ridges on our palms and soles are not continuous lines, but are characterized by certain breaks and interruptions. Ridges can also diverge or bifurcate into two branches. These phenomena give rise to different types of ridge details. Such details are minute and can be observed clearly only with the help of a magnifying aid. This is why these details are called minutiae. When we learned about the history of fingerprint science, we saw that it was Dr. Henry Faulds who proposed that fingerprints can be used for criminal identification, but he did not venture deep into studying their individual characteristics. His comparison was limited to a rough classification. Someone without a keen eye might just look at two whorl patterns and identify them as being the same. But the fact remains that each fingerprint is a marvelously complex pattern. It was Francis Galton who was not only the first person to specify fingerprints into a limited number of patterns, but also to stress that identification can be more certain if the minutiae of a fingerprint are established. Galton was the first to determine that the ridges of a fingerprint are not continuous. He theorized that the lack of continuity in ridges can be utilized to differentiate between two fingerprints of the same pattern by identifying the ridge details. To commemorate his contribution to fingerprint science, these details are known as Galton details. Galton details can be majorly classified into the following types. 1. Ridge ending. The point where a ridge ends abruptly. This is the most commonly observed detail in a fingerprint impression. 2. Bifurcation. Here, a ridge splits into two arms. Due to its shape, it is also known as a diverging fork. Bifurcations are abundantly observed in a fingerprint. 3. Trifurcation. This is similar to bifurcation, the only difference being that, in this case, the ridge splits into three ridges. However, this detail is rarely observed in an impression. 4. Interjunction. This is a small ridge that connects two parallel ridges, thus acting as a bridge. It is also known as a crossover. 5. Fragment. As the name implies, this detail is a small ridge lying in the space between two ridges. It is not connected to any of the ridges. 6. Lake. This detail is formed when a ridge branches off and joins the parent ridge again, forming an enclosure of elliptical shape. 7. Island. This is just a dot lying in the fingerprint pattern. An island and a fragment should not be confused because the latter looks more like a short ridge. 8. Intersection. Also known as changeover, this detail is observed where two ridges cross each other's paths and travel independently without ending. 9. Return. This detail consists of a ridge abruptly changing its path and taking a U-turn. And 10. Hook. Also known as a spur, this detail is observed where a small ridge curves into a hook-like shape. The ridge characteristics on a fingerprint impression can be denoted by these names. One thing to note here is that each of these details can be classified primarily as either a ridge ending or a bifurcation. Just have a look at some of these. What is a lake, a hook, an interjunction, or an intersection? All of them are fundamentally bifurcations. Similarly, each of these details has a ridge ending. Hundreds of such details can be observed in every fingerprint, but their location and their sequence matter the most in comparison. However, identifying all of the details in a single fingerprint impression is a very tedious job. Is it even necessary to locate all these ridge characteristics for comparison between two fingerprints? Let's say we have to compare the facial features of two people for identification. The first thing we might notice is that one of them has a deep permanent scar on their face, while the other does not. Also, their eye colors are different. Now, should we keep on comparing other features like their nose, ear, and lip dimensions as well? Because the earlier two features were strikingly different, we don't need to establish a relationship between the other features. Similarly, comparing each ridge characteristic is not essential to confirm identification. From the hundreds of details present in an impression, identification of only a limited number of details is sufficient. Nowadays, it is exceptionally easy to upload an impression into an automated system that recognizes all of the details present in it. However, this was not the case in the budding years of fingerprint science, when everything was to be done manually. This is the reason why there was a need to put a limit on the number of details needed for identification. Here enters one of the most popular figures in forensic science, the Sherlock Holmes of France, also known as the father of modern forensic science, Dr. Edmond Locard, who we discussed earlier in the series when we learned about the law of exchange. In 1914, Dr. Edmond Locard put forth the tripartite rule concerning fingerprint identification, aimed at establishing a standard of proof. Locard studied and compared a vast number of fingerprints and laid out his assumptions in the following manner. 1. The certainty of identity becomes beyond debate if more than 12 concurring points are existing. 2. If 8 to 12 concurring points are present, then the case is marginal and the inevitability of individuality will depend on A. the clarity of the fingerprints, B. the rarity of its form, C. the presence of the core and the delta in the available part of the print, D. the presence of pores, E. the papillary ridges and valleys, the direction of the lines, and the angular value of the junctions. 3. If lesser number of characteristics are found, then the fingerprints will not provide identification, but only an assumption to the number of points available and their clarity. From this rule, we can understand that 12 matching details is the threshold value for identification. So if more than 12 details are matching in two fingerprint impressions, they must be 100% identical. If 8 to 12 matching details are present, then the identification will depend on several different factors, including the clarity of the impression and the extensive study of the ridges and the pores present in the impression. We shall revisit this topic later in edgeoscopy and poroscopy. Moving forwards, if less than 8 details are established in an impression for comparison with a control sample, then its identification will not be certain. Now that we've learned all about individualizing a fingerprint pattern, it's time for some homework. Take your own thumbprint impression on a plain sheet of paper. From the previous tutorial, you should be able to determine its overall pattern. Now, with the help of a magnifying glass, observe the ridge characteristics and spot details such as ridge endings, bifurcations, fragments, hooks, islands, and so forth. If you do not have a magnifying glass, capture a photo on your smartphone and study the details by zooming in on them. If possible, take a magnified printout of the thumbprint, study the details in a clockwise direction, and label them accordingly. Try to identify as many Galton details as you can. Once you're finished, let's move forward and learn about fingerprint deposition.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.